Problem 6. Marvin has been tasked with writing down every list of integers with the following properties. 1. The list contains 71 terms. 2. The first term is 1. 3. Every term after the first is equal to either the previous term or the sum of all previous terms. When Marvin is finished, how many of the lists will have a sum equal to 999,999? So we're going to study this rather peculiar type of sequence that Marvin can write down. First of all, I would introduce some language. Supposing you've got a sequence, and I'll just use the easiest sequence everybody knows. From it, you can derive a second sequence called the sequence of partial sums. What you do is you add up the first few terms. So it begins with 1. The next term is 1 plus 2. The next term is 1 plus 2 plus 3. 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4, and then the sum of the numbers 1 to 5 is 15. And so from the original sequence, we have the sequence of partial sums, okay, because you're summing the parts, the first parts of the original sequence. And in this particular case, the original sequence is very natural. You expect this to be something natural. You may recognize it. You get the triangular numbers. You could carry on in the same vein. You could form the partial sums of this sequence, and so on. And you can do this with any sequence. It's often a very interesting thing to do. Sometimes when you start with a sequence, you look at the differences between adjacent terms. If you take the first sequence, the differences would all be 1. If you take this sequence, the differences are, 2, 3, 4, 5. It goes back. So if you've done a little bit of calculus, you'll see that there's an analogy here between integration and differentiation. I don't want to push that too far, but the analogy is real, and there's some interesting mathematics there. Anyway, enough of the general waffle. Let's now focus upon the particular question. So let's see what partial sums can do for us in this situation. Supposing we're looking at a particular term of the sequence that Marvin is writing down. I'll call it term T. And the sum so far is S for sum. I don't like writing them above each other. So let's keep track of this data by writing the ordered pair T, S to mean the current term is T and the partial sum so far is S. Now, Marvin can do two things. So let's see what can happen. Either Marvin repeats the term. So the next sequence, the next term will still be T. But of course, there's something to be added onto the partial sum. So the new partial sum is S plus T. On the other hand, Marvin needn't repeat. What Marvin could do is to replace the current term by the partial sum. Okay, what happens to the partial sum here? Well, the partial sum was S, and you've got a new term of S, so you need to add that on. So that's the next piece of data if you're doing this, if you call it a sum move, and I'll call that a repeat move, and I'll use the letters capital R and capital S. So Marvin does that all the time. He has one or the other. And if you start off with the given initial data, which is 1, 1, and apply these moves in a random way, it's terrifying because it seems to be chaotic behavior. And you think to yourself, how can I get control? And the answer is, you don't write down random applications of repeat moves and sum moves. You study them in a systematic way, and that's what we're going to do now. So one interesting sequence of moves you might deploy is to use the sum move, then the sum move, then the sum move repeatedly. Let's see what the effect of that is. Well, if your current term is t and your current partial sum is little s, then that moves to s2s, and that moves to 2s4s, and that moves to 4s8s, and so on. This means that, well, let's fix the length of this. Supposing we have little b s's, little b sum moves. What will happen is that t little s will, after the application of all those moves, be an ordered pair. Well, the partial sum is easy. It's going to be 2 to the b times little s, and the term will be half of that, so it'll be 2 to the power b minus 1 times little s. Now, we're actually interested primarily in the partial sum, because we want to make the partial sum equal to 999,999. What's happened to the partial sum through this process is that s has been multiplied by a power of 2. And you don't really have to notice what happens to the term. It doesn't really matter. So that's a nice controlled thing, something you could understand. And in particular, this is something we don't want to do, because introducing a factor of a power of 2 into the partial sum is likely to cause trouble when you're trying to build an odd number. Now I want to examine a second possible sequence of moves. And next I want to consider moves where you first begin with a sum move and then you do some repeats. So your initial data would be ts. Your sum move will take you to s2s. And then your first repeat move will take you to, s stays the same, and this 2s is incremented by s, so it becomes 3s. And then you do it again, s, 4s, and so on. In fact, let's consider the case where we have a string here of length a, so I'll have little a minus 1 r's and the single s at the beginning, so the whole suite of moves has length little a. What will happen to ts is that it will become s and then a plus 1 times s. So a sequence of moves of this type also has the effect on the partial sum of multiplying it by a positive integer. Now, any sequence of S's and R's, of sum moves and repeat moves, can be broken up as a sum followed by repeats in various places and padding with S's elsewhere if necessary. Think about that. Well, now it's clear that we don't want to do any repeating S moves, because if you do, you're going to introduce a power of 2 into the partial sum, and we don't want that. So we're just going to move moves of this type if we're going to build 999,999. So we're going to start off with, 1, 1, and we're going to apply sequences of this shape of moves again and again, introducing factors to in front of the partial sum, which will be, initially we're starting with 1. If we, for example, use the move sum repeat, that will take us to 1, 3. And we repeat, we do another sum and then repeat, and we get to 3, 9. And see how we've introduced an extra factor of 3 into the sum. Right, so let's see how we can build up 999,999 by using moves of this shape. So let's think about this ridiculously big number. I'm going to factorize it. Well, it's 999 times 1001, and that's true because it's obviously true by multiplication, or you're thinking of this as 1000 squared take away 1, factorizing as 1000 minus 1 times 1000 plus 1. Either way, it's true. These numbers are now sufficiently small that you can factorize them. That's got a factor of 9, and there's another factor of 3, so it's 27 times 37. And this, on the other hand, is famously 7 times 11 times 13, and if you don't know it, you could work it out. 27, of course, is 3 cubed. So we've got the prime factorization of this number, which means that we can build it up as a partial sum by using sequences of moves. And we know how to do that now. Okay, so the number we're trying to build in the partial sum is 3 cubed times 7 times 11 times 13 times 37. Now, to put a 3 in, we use an SR move, sum, then repeat, and that gives you a 3. Do that 3 times, that's going to give you 27, because you put in 3 factors of 3. So anyway, how many moves are we going to need? Well, we're going to need 3 minus 1 to the power times 3, not to the power, plus, to put in a factor of 7, we're going to need a sum followed by 5 repeats. We're going to need 6 moves. And it carries on in the same way. And you add that up, and you get 70. So, how long would your sequence be if you had started with an initial term and applied 70 moves? Answer, it would have length 71, as required. And you would have built a sequence where the partial sum was 999,999. Actually, you could have put the different primes in as factors into the partial sum in any order that you like. And there are, in fact, 7 primes here, as long as you're counting this first prime 3 times. So we have to calculate how many different orders there are of building this thing. Well, you've got the first time you put in a prime, the second time you put in a prime, up to the 7th time you put in a prime. 3 of those 7 positions are going to be occupied by the prime 3. So that's 7 choose 3. And then you've got the remaining 4 primes can occupy any one of the remaining 4 conditions, 4 positions. This is 7 choose 3, the binomial coefficient. You do the arithmetic, and it comes out to be 840. So in this way, we have discovered 840 different sequences that Marvin might build that would obey all the conditions and produce the right partial sum. But there's a concern, and we have to address it, because actually we haven't proved that these are the only sequences that do the job. So we'll do that now. You have to worry that maybe there's a way of doing this without introducing the primes one at a time. For example, you might introduce 15 in one go by a sum, repeat, repeat, repeat move. And maybe you would get the right number of terms in the sequence coming out, and this would give you extra sequences. It doesn't happen, but you have to worry. So let's see what's happened. What we've done is to put in the primes one at a time. But supposing we were going to, supposing u and v were positive integers, and u and V are actually bigger than 1. If you put in the factor UV by using sum and then repeats, that's going to take you UV minus 1 moves. On the other hand, if you put the U in as a factor and the V in a factor individually, well, put in a U is going to take you that many moves, put in a V is going to take that many moves. And I claim that this is more efficient than that. This is fewer moves. And the way to see that is to subtract one from the other. So what are we going to do? We'll take the first thing, UV minus 1, and we'll subtract the second thing, which will be minus U minus V plus 2. And what's that going to be? Well, a little bit of cancelling happens. UV minus U minus V plus 1. And joy of joys, it factorizes. Now remember that U and V were both strictly bigger than 1. So these are still positive. And so this is a positive product. It's bigger than 0. So this quantity here is strictly smaller than that one. So putting in a factor of UV takes you, in one go, takes you longer than putting in the factors of U and V separately. It takes you more moves. And then if U and V are not prime, you can repeat this argument. And in the end, what this shows is that putting in UV in one go is not as good as putting in the factors of the prime factors involved in U and V one at a time. So if there were an extra sequence other than the 840 that we found that gave you 999 as the partial sum, then it would actually have to be longer than the allowed 71 terms. So in fact, the sequences we found just before are the only ones that exist. Well done, Marvin.